وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We're now inshallah coming to the end of Ramadan. The last 10 days of Ramadan is coming our way. I wanted to talk about rulings regarding what a Muslim should do in those last 10 days. There are many things that we should do in those last 10 days. I won't be talking about every and anything. I'll be focusing on more the ahkam related to al-i'tikaf. The way that I plan to go through this topic, inshallah ta'ala, is in the following way. 6 points, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is ta'rifu al-i'tikafi. What does i'tikaf mean in the Arabic language, and what does it mean in the sharia? Number two, ghayatu. What's the ultimate goal of i'tikaf? Why are we doing i'tikaf? What's the objective of i'tikaf? وَحُكْمُهُ and its ruling. That's the first chapter, inshallah ta'ala. In the first chapter, we'll be speaking about the definition of i'tikaf, the objective of i'tikaf, and the ruling regarding al-i'tikaf. The second, inshallah ta'ala, chapter, شُرُوطُ صِحَّةِ الْاِعْتِكَافِ. The prerequisites for the i'tikaf to be correct. Number three, مَا يُفْسِدُ الْاِعْتِكَافَ وَمَا لَا يُفْسِدُهُ. What are the things that can corrupt a person's i'tikaf? And what are the things that won't corrupt your i'tikaf? Number four, or chapter four, it will be أحكام النذر الاعتكاف. أحكام the rulings regarding نذر الاعتكافي. A person does an oath and a covenant, the i'tikaf that they have to do if they make a covenant with Allah Azza wa Jalla that they're going to do i'tikaf, the rulings regarding that. The fifth one is قضاء الاعتكافي, paying back the i'tikaf. To bring back and pay back the i'tikaf. Last but not least, I'm going to go through, inshallah, مَا يُنْدَبُ لِلْمُعْتَكِفِ فِعْلُهُ. What is recommended for the one who's doing i'tikaf to come with? What are the recommended things for the mu'takif, the one who's doing i'tikaf? Those are the points that, inshallah ta'ala, I hope to go through بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ. But before I start, I want to say that the last 10 days when it would enter in the month of Ramadan, Nabiullah Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would do that which he would not do in the other 20 days of the month or the other 19 days of the month. He would do that which he wouldn't do. And then why would he focus a lot on the last 10 days? Why would he give it superiority? Why would he give it more importance than the other remaining, the other previous days of Ramadan? What is the reason? The scholars, they say it's two reasons. The first one is, it's in the last 10 days of Ramadan. It's in the last 10 days of Ramadan that Laylatul Qadr falls. The last 10 days, Laylatul Qadr, it falls there. And the hadith in Sahih Muslim, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, i'takaftu, I did i'tikaf fi al-ashr al-awwal min Ramadan. I did i'tikaf in the first 10 days of Ramadan. And then I did the i'tikaf in the 10 middle days of Ramadan. And then Jibreel came to me and he told me, Ya Muhammad, what you're looking for, it's in the last 10 days, meaning Laylatul Qadr. Then the Messenger said to the companions, فَمَنْ أَرَادَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَعْتَكِفَ فَلْيَعْتَكِفْ. Any one of you who wants to do i'tikaf, let them do i'tikaf. This hadith teaches us that the reason why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was doing i'tikaf was to find Ramadan. This was the reason why he was working hard in the last 10 days. It was because of Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr falls in the last 10 days. The second reason why one needs to work hard in those last 10 days of Ramadan, exert more effort than the other days that have passed, is because إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. Actions are based on the final moments of your life. The believer works hard the older he gets. The person works hard at the ending of their life. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would finish the Qur'an once in Ramadan with Jibreel. But the year he was dying, because his life was coming to an end, He finished it twice in the month of Ramadan with Jibreel. This shows the older you get, the closer you come to your grave, and the closer you get to death, the more you multiply your hard work and your effort. Those are the two reasons why me and you, all of us, should exert more effort and hard work in those last 10 days of Ramadan. Let's go into the topic now, inshallah ta'ala. What does al-i'tikaf mean in the Arabic language? Al-iqbalu ala shay'i wal-ihtibasu fihi. I'tikaf means in the Arabic language, it's to face something. It's to face it wholeheartedly. And it's to imprison yourself in it. And they said it comes from the word akafa ala shay'i. The person, he stayed and stuck with something. إذا أقبل عليه مواظبا لا يصرف عنه وجهه. It is when he faces something with continuation and doesn't turn his face away from it. That's what it means in the Arabic language. That's what it means in the Arabic language. And that's what is taken from the ayah, تماثيل التي أنتم لها عاكفون. Idols which you guys are doing i'tikaf under. Meaning you're staying, you're sitting and you're remaining under it. الاعتكاف means اصطلاحا هو الإقامة في المسجد بنية التقرب إلى الله عز وجل ليلا كان أو نهارا. It is to remain in the masjid with the intention to get closer to Allah by staying in the masjid. Day or night, it doesn't matter. Whether it's day or whether it's night. We've defined i'tikaf in the Arabic language and we've defined it in the Sharia. We're now going to go into what is the objective of al-i'tikaf. The objective of al-i'tikaf is عُكُوفُ الْقَلْبِ عَلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. That the heart faces Allah Azza wa Jalla. That your heart, it faces. And you imprison your heart at this moment in the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The second objective of al-i'tikaf is al-khalwatu bihi subhanahu. To be alone with Allah Azza wa Jalla. The third is al-inqita'u an ishtighali bil khalqi wa bi umuri dunya. The third reason for al-i'tikaf is al-inqita'u. It is to disconnect yourself an ishtighali bil khalqi, busy yourself with the creation and the worldly issues. You disconnect yourself from that. What is the ruling of al-i'tikaf? The ruling of al-i'tikaf is sunnah lirrijali wal nisa. It's a sunnah for the men and the women. وَهَذَا بِاتِّفَاقِ الْأَئِمَّةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. This is a consensus amongst the four imams. Not only that, الْمَذَاهِبُ الْفِقْهِيَّةِ. All of the madhabs that are followed, this is what they have. وَلِذَلِكَ some of the scholars, they transmitted an ijma' consensus. Ibn Qudam, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Mundhir and others, they transmitted an ijma' that i'tikaf is not obligatory. That it's not obligatory. It's a recommended act. So it's a sunnah for the men and it's a sunnah for the woman. Lakin, if the i'tikaf for the woman is going to lead to fitna and fasad, corruption and problems, then she's prevented from it. She's prevented from doing al-i'tikaf if there's a fear of fitna or there is no clear segregation between the men and the women. The men are going to have to sleep next to the women. Then this is prohibited and it's haram. There's no i'tikaf for the women in that instance. Also, if there's fear of fitna that might come from it, then the women are prohibited from it. Not that the i'tikaf is not a sunnah for them. Of course it is. That's the asr al-hukm, the original default position. Like in right now, we're going to move away from that because of other textual evidence that command us to abstain from fitna, trials and tribulations. Now I want to go into the second chapter, which is, what are the conditions that are needed for someone's i'tikaf to be correct? If they don't come with these conditions, your i'tikaf is incorrect. The first one is al-Islam. The person has to be a Muslim. هذا باتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. Four madhabs, they unanimously agree upon it. And they took the ayah from Allah Azza wa Jalla, وَمَا مَنَعَهُمْ أَن تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ نَفَقَاتُهُمْ إِلَّا أَنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ. There's nothing that prevented their sadaqah being accepted except that they were disbelievers. The reason why their sadaqah wasn't accepted, Allah said in that verse, is because they were not believers. The second condition is al-aqlu, that the person has sanity. And sanity is a condition for the acceptance of al-i'tikaf. And this is based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the messenger said, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ. The pen is lifted from three. And from the three that the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned was, وَعَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَعْقِلَ. The insane one until he gains sanity again. The third condition for the acceptance of al-i'tikaf is التمييزُ. The person has reached age of tamiz. Tamiz is to puberty. وَهَذَا بِاتِّفَاقِ الْأَئِمَّةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. This is based upon the view of the four a'immas. The four a'immas. And the evidence that they use for this is إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Intentions is needed for the i'tikaf. And if the child is young, he doesn't know what he's doing the i'tikaf for, he is most likely not going to come with intentions. So the child doesn't have an intention, and that is their evidence. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. And this is اتفاق المذاهب الأربعة, the حنفية, the مالكية, the شافعية, and the حنابلة. They all agree upon that. The fourth one is النية, intention. Intention is a condition. It's required. And the evidence for that is إنما الأعمال بالنية, حديث عمر رضي الله عنه. And a couple of scholars, they transmitted a consensus in this issue. From them is Ibn Rushd. Ibn Rushd, he transmitted a consensus, and Ibn Juzay, that an intention is needed for i'tikaf. The fifth is إذن الزوج لزوجته. The woman has to take permission from her husband. This is a consensus that the scholars transmitted. From who? المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة, the four madhabs. All of them agree. And they also used the famous hadith of Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها in Sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim. So it's taken from that evidence. The sixth condition is that it has to be done in a masjid. Consensus has been transmitted in this regard. Ibn Abdul Barr transmitted a consensus. Ibn Qudama transmitted a consensus. Al-Qurtubi transmitted a consensus. And Ibn Taymiyyah transmitted a consensus. The second point that I want to mention regarding the masjid is, can a person do i'tikaf in other than the three masajids? This is a difference of opinion. لكن the four madahib al-fiqhiyyah al-arba'ah, they all say that the person can do i'tikaf in what? He can do i'tikaf in other than the three masajids. And they use the general ayah, وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. You're doing i'tikaf in what? Al-masajid. They made al-masajid here, they said it's a lil-umum istighraqiyya. It means all of the masajids. Okay? But we've discussed that's not the strongest opinion to us. We've discussed that this opinion is not the strongest to us. But this is what many people are going to follow regardless. The third point that I want to mention regarding the masjid is the masjid which the person is going to do i'tikaf in has to be a masjid that the congregation is done. This is the qawl al-hanafiyya and the hanabila, and it's the view chosen by Ibn Baz and Ibn Uthaymin. What about if the masjid is a masjid where the jum'ah is not done? Jum'ah is actually not done. If the masjid there is no jum'ah, it is permissible. And this is بالتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة, and it's a call of طائفة من السلفي. Another fifth point that I want to mention regarding the masjid, is it permissible for the person to climb the minaret in the masjid? Would that be still considered part of the masjid? Because we're going to talk about the conditions of leaving the masjid and come inside in the masjid soon. The جمهور العلماء, like the Hanafi and the Shafi'i, they said it's permissible. There's nothing wrong with that. What about climbing the roof of the masjid or doing i'tikaf in there on the roof of the masjid? Again, the roof of the masjid or climbing at the top of the masjid, according to the madhab al-jumhur, the overwhelming majority of scholars, Hanafi and the Shafi'i and the Hanabila, it is that it's permissible. There's nothing wrong with it. The seventh one is at-tahara, purification. The tahara we're talking about here is mimma yujibu al-ghusla, that which necessitates ghusl. Okay? And we're talking about doing i'tikaf here is that person starts his i'tikaf with in major impurity. But if it happens to him, whilst it's going on, we're going to talk about that inshallah ta'ala soon. If it's major impurity, it is not permissible to start i'tikaf except with the tahara. You have to start your i'tikaf with the tahara. Like janaba, hayd, or nifas. Clean yourself from that and then come to do i'tikaf. And that's بإتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. The four مذاهب الفقهية الأربعة agree upon that. What about minor impurity? The minor impurity لا يشترط للإعتكاف الطهارة من الحدث الأصغري. There's no condition for that. You don't have to. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah in more than one place he transmitted an ijma', and he even says, I've never come across anyone who said it's not allowed. The eighth point that we want to talk about, which is a condition, is zamanu li'itikafi, the duration of the i'tikaf. Couple of points I want to mention in that is al-waqtu alladhi yajuzu fi al-i'tikaf wa mata yata'akkadu. The time in which the i'tikaf is permitted and when is it emphasized on. I'tikaf is permissible for the whole entire year. That's one thing. It's permissible to do i'tikaf in the whole entire year. You can. But it's highly emphasized on in Ramadan. And the one who transmitted that is Ibn Abd al-Barr, and ijma' on that, Ibn Muflih al-Ramli and Buhuti. Point number two, the time in which it starts. When does it start? The one who wants to do i'tikaf, when does it start? In the last 10 days of Ramadan. We've already mentioned that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he done it in the first 10 days, and then he done it in the second 10 days, and then he pushed it to the last 10 days. Salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi. The question here is that when does it start? When does the i'tikaf actually start? If I'm going to do the last 10 days, when does it start? The scholars have two opinions regarding when should the i'tikaf start in the last 10 days of Ramadan. The first view is it starts before the sun sets, okay, the night before the i'tikaf you're going to do. So the Arabs, they call it Laylat Ihda wa Ishirina, the 21st night. But that's how the Arabs, the night before, they count it like that. Okay? وَهَذَا بِاتِّفَاقِ الْمَذَاهِبِ الْفِقِّيَةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. The four madhab fiqhis, that's what they agree upon. So the first view is the sun sets, before it becomes Maghrib, before iftar, you have to be in the masjid. On the 21st night. وَهَذَا بِاتِّفَاقِ الْمَذَاهِبِ الْفِقِّيَةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. And that is a consensus amongst the what? The four madhabs. The second view is, i'tikaf starts مِنْ بَعْدِ صَلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ. It starts after صَلَاةُ الْفَجْرِ. On what day? الْيَوْمِ الْحَادِ وَالْعِشْرُونَ. The 21st, from Fajr onwards it starts. And that's a riwayah of Imam Ahmad. And it's the view that was chosen by Ibn al-Mundhir, Ibn al-Qayyim, al-San'ani, and Ibn Baz. Point number three that I want to mention regarding the duration is, when does the i'tikaf finish in the last 10 days of Ramadan? It finishes في أيام العشر الأواخر من بعد غروب الشمس آخر يوم من رمضان. Ends and it finishes after Salatul Maghrib, after sunset, on the last night of that night where they are announcing whether it's Eid tomorrow or not. That night after sunset is when it ends. Okay? And that's هذا باتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. The four madhabs, that's what they believe, that is after the sunset. Okay? And that's when they're going to really announce it in the UK and other countries like that. That's when they announce it, or other countries in the world, that's when they announce it's Eid tomorrow in the masjid. So if you're doing i'tikaf, that's when you leave the masjid, after that, after you've done your iftar. The fourth point that I want to mention is, what is the أقل مدة الاعتكاف? What's the bare minimum of doing i'tikaf? The scholars, they say, لا حد لأقل مدة للاعتكاف. Some scholars, they said, there isn't the bare minimum. There's no bare minimum. Okay? The bare minimum of how small you can do the i'tikaf, there is no, it can be as small as between two salahs. This is a view taken by the Hanafi and the Shafi'iyah. It's a qawl of the Hanabila, and it's the view chosen by Ibn Hazm al-Shawkani, Ibn Baz, and Ibn Abd al-Barr. He said, huwa qawlu. It is the view of akthar al-fuqaha, the overwhelming majority of the fuqaha. The fifth point that I want to mention regarding the duration of i'tikaf is, what is the longest i'tikaf can be for? This, which is the longest that the i'tikaf can be for, it has no, it can be for as long as the person wants it to be. And there's a consensus on that. There's no difference of opinion on that. The scholars that transmitted the consensus are Al-Imam al-Nawwi, Ibn Mulaqin, and Ibn Hajar. Three Shafi'i scholars. They transmitted a consensus in that regard. Number point number nine that I want to mention, which is اشتراط الصوم للاعتكاف. Is there a condition for the one who is doing i'tikaf having to fast? Is there a condition? We'll say that the i'tikaf is accepted from the one who's not fasting. وهو قول الشافعية. This is the قول of the madhab الشافعي. And it's very famous عند الحنابلة, according to the حنابلة. And it is also قول طائفة من السلف. A large amount of the Salaf said this. It's the view chosen by Ibn Hazm, Ibn Daqiq al-Eid, Ibn Baz, and Ibn Uthaymeen, رحمهم الله جميعا. We're now going to go into the third chapter, which is what is it that can corrupt a person in i'tikaf and what doesn't corrupt an i'tikaf. The first one is الخروج بجميع البدن بغير عذر. The person leaving the masjid with his whole entire body when there is no legislated reason. I mean, there's no reason for it. So there's no haja and there's no darura. Both of those we have to mention. You would have to know the difference between the two. There is no need for it and there's no necessity for it. Okay, Ibn Hazm transmitted a consensus that if that person who there's no need for him to leave the masjid, there's no necessity for them for him to leave the masjid, and he leaves, Ibn Hazm transmitted an ijma' batala i'tikafuhu. That is, i'tikaf is null and void. It's destroyed. The second point is the person leaving with their whole entire body, fully leaving the masjid, but there's a reason. And the reason can be one of two. It's either a worldly reason. Qada'i haja. He has to fulfill his needs. He needs to go to the toilet. So the toilet is outside the masjid. Or he has to get something to eat. Or وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. That's called a, fuqaha call it a hissi. A udhr hissi. It's a tangible excuse. The second one is a shar'i excuse, such as al-wudu. He has to go and do wudu, and that's in some place outside. And other than that, that person's i'tikaf is not null and void, and Ibn al-Mundhir and al-Mawardi, Ibn Qudama and Nawi transmitted ijma' in that issue. What about if the person leaves with some of his body? Some of his body is in the masjid, and some of it's outside the masjid. لا بأس به للمعتكف. It's no problem with that. And it doesn't corrupt his i'tikaf. And that is the consensus by the four what? باتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. The four madhabs, they all agree upon that. Point number four. الجماع, sexual intercourse, is prohibited from the mu'takif. And it will destroy his i'tikaf. And that's a consensus, no difference of opinion in that. Ibn al-Mundhir, al-Jassas, Ibn Hazm, Ibn Abd al-Barr, Ibn Qudama, al-Qurtubi, and Nawawi all transmitted ijma'. No difference of opinion in that. Number five, al-ihtilam, wet dream. If the mu'takif, he has wet dream, then this does not corrupt his i'tikaf. It doesn't. But it's upon him to do ghusl, clean himself, and he carries on his i'tikaf. He carries on. And that's a unanimous agreement amongst the al-madahib al-fiqhiyyat al-arba'ah. The four madahib al-fiqhiyyat, that's what they all agree upon. Number six, al-mubasharat wal-qubla. بشهوتين, touching or kissing his wife out of desires. The mu'takif is prohibited from touching or kissing his wife with shahwa. Ibn al-Mundhir and al-Mawardi and Ibn Abd al-Barr and Ibn Kathir and Shawkani transmitted an ijma' that it's prohibited from the person to do so. Number seven, a woman while she's doing i'tikaf, her menses starts. I'm a postnatal bleeding or whatever, or something happens to her, okay? Then we go back to the issue, is a woman allowed to stay in the masjid while she's on her menses or not? If you're of the opinion that she can't, then you'll say that she would have to leave the masjid. She'll leave the masjid and she would go where? She'll go home. The ones who believe, no, she doesn't have to leave the masjid and are of that opinion, then of course they're going to say, carry on and stay in the masjid. What both parties like can agree upon is, whether she goes home or whether she stays in the masjid, she's always going to carry on her i'tikaf later. She can still carry on. So she goes home, because of the hajj that happened to her, she can come back to the masjid and stay there and finish off whatever's remaining from her i'tikaf. And this is the view held by Madhab al-Jumhur. The overwhelming majority of scholars said this. And this is the Maliki and the Shafi'i and the Hanabila. She comes back to the masjid and she does her i'tikaf from where she left off. The ones who believe she can stay in the masjid, then of course they're saying that she should stay in the masjid, or she can stay in the masjid. What about if a person, whilst in the masjid, they become unconscious or they lose their sanity? The same thing with them. If they regain their sanity and consciousness, then they carry on their i'tikaf, just like the menses, the woman who's on her menses, they carry on. And that's the view of the Jumhur al-Malikiyyat and Shafi'i and Hanabila. Number 9, ar-ridda, apostasy. Apostasy corrupts the i'tikaf. And that's the view of the al-madahib al-fiqhiyyat al-arba'ah. That's a unanimous agreement from all the four madahib al-arba'ah. Number 10, al-ma'asi, sins. Sins do not corrupt and do not nullify a person's i'tikaf. But it's obligatory upon everyone who's doing i'tikaf to stay away from sins. But if a sin happens from him, then he doesn't destroy his i'tikaf, even if that sin which they did is a major sin, such as backbiting, tail-bearing, and other than that. And that's the view of the Jumhur, the overwhelming majority of scholars, like the Hanafi and the Shafi'i and the Hanabila, and it's a qawlu lil Malikiya, and it's a view held by the Malikiya. Now we're going to go into ahkamu nadhri al-i'tikaf, the rulings regarding the nadhr of i'tikaf. A person makes a nadhr, an oath, that they're going to do i'tikaf. We're going to speak about this in a couple of ways. 4 points, inshallah ta'ala. Point number one. Anyone who doesn't nadhru li'tikaf, فَإِنَّهُ يَلْزَمُ الْوَفَاءُ بِهِ, has to fulfill it and do it. That is بِاتِفَاق الْمَذَاهِبِ الْفِقِيَةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. The four madhabs, this is what they believe. But if a person makes a nadhr, an oath, a covenant, a promise to do i'tikaf in the three masajids, they specifically say the three masjids, Masjid al-Haram, Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Masjid al-Aqsa, then فعليه الوفاء بنذره. This person has to fulfill the nadhr that they made, وهو مذهب الجمهور المالكية والشافعية والحنابلة. And this is the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars, the مالكية and the شافعية and the حنابلة. Point number 3, حكم من نذر الاعتكاف قبل إسلامي. A person makes a nadhr, okay, a promise and an oath to do i'tikaf, but this is before they became a Muslim, okay, then he has to fulfill it after his Islam. And this is the view of Ahlul Zahir. This is the view of the Zahiriyah. And it's a riwayah on Imam Ahmad. And it's a view chosen by Ibn Battal, Al-Baghawi, Al-San'ani, Al-Shanqiti, Ibn Uthaymeen. This is the view that they all chose. Point number 4. مَنْ نَذَرَ اِعْتِكَافَ يَوْمٍ هَلْ يَدْقُلُ فِيهِ اللَّيْلُ. A person made a nadhr, a promise, i'tikaf yawmin. He said, I'm going to do i'tikaf a day. Okay? Does the night enter it? Sometimes the word yawm is used as layla as well. The jumhur al-ulama, such as the Hanafi and the Shafi'i and the Hanabila, they believe that if he says, I'm going to do i'tikaf yawm, a day, then the night doesn't enter it. He just has to do it for a day, not the night. We're now going to go into the fifth chapter that we want to speak about, which is qada'ul i'tikafi, bringing back and paying back the i'tikaf. Point number 1, the paying back of the i'tikaf, which is highly recommended. The highly recommended i'tikaf to pay back. If a person, al-mu'takif tatawu'an idha abtala i'tikafahu ba'da shuru'i fihi, if the one who is doing i'tikaf, and the i'tikaf that he was doing was a voluntary i'tikaf, it was a nadhar, it was tatawu', like the 10 days of Ramadan, and then it broke from him after he went into it. He maybe had done a day or two. He got in and then it broke. It's highly recommended for him to pay back. It's recommended. وَلَا يَلْزَمُهُ, it is not obligatory on him. وَمَذْهَبُ الشَّافِعِيَّةَ وَالْمَحَنَابِلَةِ وَقَوْلٌ لِلْحَنَفِيَّةِ. This is the view of the Shafi'iyah and the Hanabila, and what a view of the Hanafiyah. Number 2, قضاء الاعتكاف المنذور إذا فات أو فسد. A person made a promise to Allah Azza wa Jalla, which we just spoke about, nadhar. Okay? What about if he misses it? Or it gets corrupted? His i'tikaf that he was doing, it got corrupted for some reason, for whatever reason it may be. Or he missed it. Anyone who does a nadhar of i'tikaf, and then he breaks it for whatever reason it may be, or it gets corrupted for whatever reason it may be, that he doesn't fulfill it, then it's obligatory for him to bring it back, because it was wajib in the first place. You made an oath. Nadhar is obligatory for you to fulfill. This is the ijma' was transmitted by Ibn Rushdin, Az-Zurqani and Ibn Qasim. They transmitted an ijma'. Number three, qada'u al-i'tikaf al-wajib 'an al-mayyit. An i'tikaf that was obligatory on a dead person. Someone died, and he made an oath, a nadhar, that he's going to do i'tikaf. And before he can do it, he died. He didn't do the i'tikaf. The scholars, they differed in this issue. Whether it's istihbab qada'i waliyihi, the person who falls under the guardianship of this person, should they pay it back for them? Is it recommended for them to pay it back for them? Or not? There's a discussion. And there's two views. You can't say it's obligatory, aslan. The reason you can't say it's obligatory is because if you say that i'tikaf of that person becomes obligatory on me, okay, or on the person, then where would you take the ayah? فَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَىٰ. A person is going to be punished for another person's obligation. صح? So here the discussion is that the scholars differed, is istihbab, the recommendation. Is it recommended? There's two views. The first view is لا يستحب لوليه أن يقضيه عنه. It's not recommended for what? It's not recommended for the wali to what? To pay back for this person. It's not recommended. So what does he do? He gives food in his regard. This is madhab al-jumhur. It's the view of the majority. It's madhab al-jumhur. Al-hanafiyyah wal-malikiyyah wal-shafi'iyyah. The second view is yustahabbu liwalihi, the wali is recommended to pay it back that i'tikaf, and this madhab is the Hanabila, wa qawlu lishafi'i, and it's a view of Imam al-Shafi'i, a statement of Imam al-Shafi'i, wa akhtarahu ibn Uthaymeen, and Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he chose it, and that seems to be the strongest, and it's recommended for him. We're now going to speak about the last and final point, which is afdaliyatul i'tikafi zamanan wa makanan wa masail ukhra. We're now going to go into the virtues of i'tikaf in terms of places, timings, and other issues related to that. Number one, what is the best time to do i'tikaf? The best time to do i'tikaf is that which is in Ramadan. And within Ramadan, what is highly recommended and highly chosen is في العشر الأواخر منه, the last 10 days. وهذا باتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. The four madhabs is what they agree upon. Point number two, أفضل أماكن الاعتكاف, the best place to do i'tikaf, is المسجد الحرامي. Then after that comes المسجد النبوي. And then after that comes المسجد الأقصى. And then after that comes المساجد الجامع. The masajid that have جمعة and جماعة. وهذا باتفاق المذاهب الفقهية الأربعة. And in that order that we mentioned it in is the unanimous agreement of the four fiqh schools that are followed. Number three, اشتغال المعتكف بالعبادات المختصة به. Things that the person who's doing i'tikaf busies himself with. It is highly recommended for the mu'takif to busy himself بالقرب والعبادات المختصة به. That he busies himself with عبادات and things that are specific for him, such as كقراءة القرآن. Things that are unique for him, just exclusive to him, such as reciting the Qur'an, and dhikr, and salah, but make sure that salah is not في غير وقت النهي, in the times which is not prohibited. Okay, be careful. That's the best thing for you. I'tikaf is not good to indulge into other people and doing things. No, it's best to do actions which are specific to you. That's what's recommended greatly. Point number four, the ruling of silence in the whole of i'tikaf. The person doesn't choose to talk, and that they think that's the best thing and they want to get closer to Allah by doing that, then the Fuqaha al-Hanafiyya and the Hanabila, they mentioned that this is not right. Like in Ibn Taymiyyah, he transmitted an ijma' that this is a bid'ah. Transmitted as a ijma' Ibn Taymiyyah, ala bid'iyyati dhalika. That this is an innovation by consensus. Point number five, حكم عقد النكاح للمعتكفي. A person getting married while he's doing i'tikaf, or he's doing nikah for others while he's in i'tikaf, this issue, whether he's marrying or whether he's marrying someone else off, there's nothing wrong with it. It's not a problem. He can do that. And there's a consensus in this issue. Al-Imam al-Tahawi and Ibn Abd al-Barr and Nawawi transmitted the ijma' that it's permissible whether he's getting married or whether he's marrying someone else off. That is what I wanted to go through with all of you, inshallah ta'ala, regarding the ahkam of al-i'tikaf. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.